What happened was there was an old man, was he had a dream. And in this dream, he saw a visitor coming across that great water. This man with a pale skin was on this log and he was coming. And in his dream, he saw this man step down from the log, and this man was smiling. And his hand was out in friendship. And they greeted each other. And a great series of events happened in that part of his dream. He saw that in his vision. But that vision also had another side to it. What he saw was this man was wearing an evil sneer, and he was growling like this. And it said that that man would even steal our spirit. He would take our spirit from us. So this dream disturbed this old man so much was he took it to that Confederacy meeting. And he told those leaders there that dream. So what happened was, that's what broke up that great Confederacy, was that dream. Three of those people said, he's coming in friendship. We're going to stay here and we're going to meet him with friends, as brothers. We're going to stay here. In fact, we're going to prepare for his coming, is what they said. Three of those other people said, no, he's coming to take. All he wants to do is take, is what they said. So nowadays, those three people are known as Ojibwe, Potawatomi, and Odawa. And what they did in that part of the prophecy, what it said was the turtle would dive deep down into the ocean, and he would bring up a miga shell, which is a small cowrie shell. And the miga shell would lead them on a migration. And they would follow that shell to a place where food floats upon the water. And what they were talking about was wild rice. The Anishinaabe word for wild rice, manomen, that means little wee pieces of the Creator. That's how sacred that food is. Little pieces of the Creator. So those three people, that's what they would do, is they would move away from the ocean. And the seventh nation, what they said, we're not going to judge right now. We're going to wait and see what he's like. Then we'll make a decision. So those people nowadays are known as the Wabanaki people. So the people who went on this migration, that's what they did. They moved away from the Atlantic Ocean. We moved up the St. Lawrence River. And the thing is, this journey didn't take a short time. It wasn't like we all just jumped in our Winnebagoes and got there by fall. It took generations. And as we moved up the St. Lawrence River, we came to places where there was wild rice. So some of our people said, this is the place. And we stayed there for a bit. And then the prophecy reminded us, no, this wasn't the place. So some moved, while others stayed there. So we moved up this, what they call this migration story, up the St. Lawrence River to the chain of lakes they were called. Lake Ontario, Lake Erie, Lake Huron, Lake Superior, Lake Michigan, moved along there. And we got stuck six times. Six times we got stuck. We thought we were there, but we weren't there. We had to keep moving. We stopped at Montreal for a while. We stopped at Niagara Falls for a while. We stopped near Sarnia, Ontario for a while. We stopped at Manitoulin Island for a while. And then we even overshot. We went to Duluth, Minnesota. That was too far. And we came back to Wisconsin, the place called Madeline Highlands. That's where we were supposed to end up. But that journey took generations. And you have to understand that as we move through, diplomacy is a big thing amongst our people. And years ago, when we were bringing back some of our culture, my community, Wasoxing, used to do social dancing with the local Mohawk community, Wata. So those at one time used to fight. In fact, my community used to say that to me. Why are you hanging around with those Mohawks? They used to eat us. And that's what the Mohawks were hearing too from their community. Why are you playing with those Ojibwe's? They used to eat us. So we did that. We were young and idealistic, so we had these social dances. But we remembered that diplomacy. When the Iroquois came to our community, they would ask us, Ojibwe people, we believe the world moves in a clockwise fashion. Because the fundamental belief of us is the earth is our center. Everything moves around that. So the sun moves around the earth. The Mohawks believe the other way, that it moves the other way. They understand that how the cosmos moves that different way, you know, everything moves around the sun. So they see movement as that way. That's a major difference in those two cultures. And we're neighbors side by side. So they used to come to our territory and ask us if they could dance the other way, their own way. And they'd be given permission. Just like when we went into their territory, we would ask them if we could dance the Anishinaabe way, and they would let us. There's all sorts of jokes about that, eh? They used to tell people, you know those Ojibwe's, they'll wind you up. But we'll unwind you, okay? So, diplomacy was really good. So during this migration, as we moved along this area, there was very diplomatic. There was a lot of, you know, political protocol to follow. But there were just too many of us. And we were three nations that were coming along. So as we moved through here, conflict started. Because we had families to feed, we had resources to use, so we became kind of rude. And we had conflicts with the Iroquoian people as we came through here. And then as we got north of here, we had conflicts with the Cree, because we were using their resources. And then when we ended up in northwestern Ontario, there were people there called Dakota Sioux that we created conflicts with because we were overusing resources there. So when we got there in northwestern Ontario, what happened though was we did start a war with them because we needed a place to live once we got to the promised land. So what happened in the stories is the men who were hunters stood up in front of the women and they asked the women, we need land to raise our families, feed our children. Can we start a war with these people and push them away so we can have this land to live? So the story teaching says, the women agreed with that. What you are asking makes sense, is what they were told. So they started a war with the Dakota and pushed them out of the woodlands. That's why you see a lot of Ojibwe people in northwestern Ontario, Manitoba. As they started that war and they pushed the Dakota out onto the Great Plains. We didn't know we were doing ourselves a disservice, eh? Because when Hollywood came along, and they walked out onto the Great Plains, who did they see? The Sioux. That's why when you conceptualize an Indian person, what do you think of? War bonnet. A Sioux war bonnet. What do you think we live in? Teepees. And y'all think we're good horseback riders, eh? So Ojibwe's were a little bit resentful of that because we were in the bush and no one discovered us. They were really happy about Adam Beach and those other Ojibwe actors. Finally, see one of our own in Hollywood. So that war that we started, it lasted almost 200 years. Oh. And they say the women told the men to stop, but their words fell upon deaf ears. Because as men, we become enamored with warfare, right? We like that. It really changes our thinking. What happened in this story, though, they say a little girl came and she dreamed about a drum like that, that it would bring peace to those nations. And that's what it did. It stopped that war, the big powwow drum that you see. So that ended that conflict, and in our people, that's where we live. That little island in the Madeline Island, that's the center of our home now. If we had a capital city, that's where it would be. So the Anishinaabe people live here. So here in central Ontario, there were two kinds of Anishinaabe people here. There were the kind that stayed here during the migration. So you're talking 800 to 1200 years ago that people stayed here. You want truth? Evidence? I always get asked, where's your evidence to your stories? One time I had to go to court to defend the traditional view. I spent 4 days on the stand. 3.5 days was listening to arguments why my belief wasn't valid. After 3.5 days, they finally decided, okay, he's a credible witness. What his grandmother told him is true. What his teachers have told him is true and is believable in his court. But it took 3.5 days for that. And then my little part in that court case only lasted about 45 minutes. So that's what people say, where is the truth to all of this? You only have to go to Peterborough, Ontario. There's the Petroglyphs Provincial Park there. They've got a big glass building covered now, eh? So it's easy. If you go there and you look at those rock carvings, a lot of what I'm speaking about is there. A lot of our teachings are there, right in that grandfather, they're carved there. And those were carved about 1,200 years ago, as we came through here. So that was proof that this migration story is true. You'll see boats in that carved, eh, of those tall hats. You'll see those there. So even before the Europeans came here, we saw that. So as we moved through this migration here, that's what disturbed the territories of the Hurons, the Mohawks, the Cree, and the Dakota, was the insurgence of the Anishinaabe people into this part of the world. Now that's how it happened. There were a couple of groups, though, that kept going. A small group went to the Rocky Mountains near Hinton, Alberta. And they lived there, hidden for years. They remembered and practiced our cultures the way they had always been given. And in the early 1960s, an old man came down. His name was Akinene, or Peter O'Cheese. And he's one of the ones, one of the principals in the reviving of our culture and our history. He grew up in an environment where they had all of our stories, all of our teachings. And he brought that here to Canada. Another group of people, and this is the one I wish I'd been associated with, actually went down to where San Diego is now. A small band went down there and lived down there, near San Diego. In fact, the Potawatomi people, what they do is they keep a log, and all the research they've done in the Potawatomi land claim is they keep a record of anybody named John Rice. I'm in their books. So because there was a chief, his name was John Rice, and they say he was crying for his people as they were taken across the Mississippi River. So they keep a record of anybody named. If I'd known that, maybe Musquamquit's name would be John now. Because it's an important name in the Potawatomi history. But there's a John Rice in San Diego who's a surfboard maker, right? That could have been me. So this migration that happened, that's why you see in this part of the world now where the people are. The Iroquoian people, the Cree, the Dakota, and the Menominee, and the Fox, and the Sauk. You see that encouragement of those three nations that came through here. They created what you see today. So there are some questions that I have, some singers here. We're going to sing around that song for you. Originally, when we were talking about planning on this, and we're going to do around that dance. But we thought maybe only our close family members would show up. Maybe 40 people. There'd be enough room to do a dance. But there's a lot of people here and there's not enough room to dance. So if anybody has a couple of quick questions, I'll try to answer them.
What is Anishinaabe
saying? Anishinaabe, that's what we call ourselves. In our creation story, we were lowered from the sky world down to this earth. So Anishinaabe means he who is lowered from the sky world. Yep.
If you could spend an evening, you're interested
in learning, talking to someone, who would it be? Me?
Yeah, who would you like to spend an evening listening to and hearing what they have to share with you that you think would be meaningful to you?
There's a couple of chiefs that I have. His name is Jim Dumont. Oh. He's our Eastern Norway chief. I would like to spend some time with him listening to his stories. Or even our grand chief, Eddie Benton Benet. Because they have a lot of stories, not only about our ancient culture, but how they've seen that
come back to our people. Anybody else? Yeah.
CBC ran a series called Eight Fire. Mm-hmm. You spoke about the Confederacy of the Seven Fires. What does the Eighth Fire mean?
Okay, that prophecy I talked about is called the Seventh Fire Prophecy. And what happens is there will be seven fires. And that's been proven historically. It's, if you ever want to research it, it's on Google. It even talks about a time when there's going to be false prophets. So, but basically it's been...
You were talking earlier about that the native people weren't heard and they didn't have a word in the government. I think it is really telling that, you know, starting with the G20 and before, that we white people now also are not being heard as far as the government is concerned. So I think, you know, we've come around full circle. Would you agree with that?
Yeah. There's probably going to be a resurgence of friendship societies.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, one of the things that's really important for the human condition, and I use that word, human condition. Our people were talking about colonization and rediscovering our culture, our language, and who we were. We call that decolonization. We're learning about how to decolonize ourselves from the colonization process. Not only white people, but all people around the world. We need to remember that this colonization has gone on over history time and time and time again. And we need to resolve within ourselves to stop that as humans. To assume that we can subjugate another human being.
Right.
You know, to end that kind of mentality. Yeah. And to honor the existence as humans. Like, we can all grasp that concept of honoring this creation and feeling connected to it. But sometimes we're a little bit reluctant in honoring our interpersonal interconnections, eh? Into connecting with each other as a human. So to open, take that much further, because each one of you in this room, if you go back in your family history, you come from races that have been colonized and decolonized.
Yes.
You know? Northern Europe and the Romans, you'll hear that. Various nations all around the world, you'll hear about that colonization happened. So as humans, we've got to think about that, and that would be As a white person, to understand your history regarding colonization. You can understand how us Indian people feel if you go back and listen to how your people felt about that. And that would create an awareness that maybe colonization wouldn't happen again. But one of the things we're encouraging everyone to do is to go back and learn about their indigenous knowledge, where they came from. As far as we were all indigenous people at one time, and so did to rediscover your indigenous roots in harmony.
You refer to the Americans as the land of the long knives,
mm-hmm.
and you explained why. Do you have a similar name for the Canadians?
Yeah, no, Miss Hakim, the grandmother land. And you can blame that one on Queen Victoria. There were a couple of differences between how the Aboriginal people were treated. Up here in Canada, we were under the Department of Citizenship and Immigration. So bureaucrats.
Amazing.
Down in the States, it was the Department of the Interior, which was the military. So that's why they had the Indian Wars. Their negotiators had guns and knives with them. Up here, they were just bureaucrats who had pad and paper and bureaucracy. So those two differences. But here in Canada, it was seen as more of a refuge because we could get away from the long knives.
Both had equally devastating.
Yeah, both had equally devastating results.